to stand. I hope I reach it once again, and I'm feeling the same way all over again. Feeling the same way all over again. Singing the same lines all over again, no matter how much I pretend. Oh, singing the same lines all over again, no matter how much I pretend, no matter how much I pretend. I tried so hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do is just some evil scheme. A memory from your lonesome past keeps us so far apart. Why can't I free doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart? Another love before my time made your heart sad and blue. And so my heart is paying now for things I didn't do. In anger, unkind words I say that make the teardrops start. Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming to our session. We are going to start, so we're inviting our friends outside to join us. So first off, you know, we would like to ask the audience a show of hands, since all of our panelists are native Arabic speakers. We were wondering whether we would you would rather have this session in Arabic or have it in English. Who's for English? Just give us a show of hands. And who's for Arabic? Okay. Well, I warn you, my Arabic is awful, so. we can use both, since we have our translators back. So dear panelists, use whatever language you feel comfortable with, and we have our translators at the back. So, welcome everybody. Today we are going to talk about change and challenges in the MENA region. It's a very regionally focused panel with activists and internet users from the region, very prominent, who have been following the Arab uprisings and other events throughout the last 3 or 4 years. Let me introduce myself. My name is Hisham Al-Murat. I'm director at Global Voices Advocacy, which is the advocacy arm of Global Voices, which is a broad organization of over 1,500 volunteers across the world. And the idea is to defend freedom of expression online. And today, we have a very distinguished panel. We have Zineb Bemqaddem, who's a Moroccan activist. She's one of the most remarkable and recognizable faces of the so-called February 20th movement in Morocco. She's also co-founder of a citizen media project called manfakinch.com, which in Arabic means, in English means, we will not give up. It's a website that curates and aggregates citizen media, more precisely dissident citizen media material in Morocco, and disseminates it across the web. We have our friend Mohamed Talakieh, who's the communications officer at the at a very prominent Jordanian organization at the forefront of the defense of digital rights in this country, which is called the Jordan Open Source Association. It's a community-based movement promoting open source and free culture in Jordan. We have Slim Amamou, who's a former Tunisian Secretary of State and a self-described highest-ranked pirate in government, which is a fact, by the way. He self-describes himself as soft power alchemist and open source analyst and trust systems craftsman. And we have also our friend Sami Bin Gharbia, who's the founding director of Global Voices Advocacy. So full disclosure, that's the organization I work for. He's also co-founding of an award-winning project called Nawat.org. It's a celebrated citizen media platform, an award-winning citizen media platform that played a crucial role during the uprisings here in Tunisia, and a major civil society player today. So, as an introduction, a 3 hours drive from here, where we are here right now, there is a small town called Sidi Bouzid. And in late 2010, there was this vendor who set himself on fire. His name, of course, is Bouazizi, and he sparked the Arab uprising, and it was a major historical event, of course. We've been all following the Arab uprisings, and we've been following the aftermath of the Arab uprisings. But somehow the Arab revolutions have had direct and also unintended consequences, if you like. Since the toppling of Ben Ali here in Tunisia and Mubarak in Egypt, and also other major changes in other parts of the Arab world, we are living in a different place than we were before, at least as far as the internet is concerned. We moved from a position where governments were kind of agnostic about the fact, about the internet, about the power of the internet, about how the internet can mobilize, or how can it be a force to, mobilize opposition, and in some cases be an existential threat for some of those regimes. I know this is something that is not, that is controversial. Not everybody agrees that the internet has played that role, but at least we know that today governments are investing, at least in this region of the world, they're investing billions of dollars in order to acquire state-of-the-art technology, basically mass surveillance technology, most of the time working hand in hand with private companies, most of those companies based in the West, in North America or in Europe, to basically spy on their people and to control the internet, to try to transpose or recreate the same oppressive structures that they have created offline, to try to recreate those, you know, those structures online. We have seen attacks against the very infrastructure of the internet as we know it. And I think everybody here has the PRISM scandal or affair in mind, and how that really has shaken the belief that the internet was a safe place for everybody to have a private, you know, conversation, or to be able to express oneself freely without fear of retribution. So today, with this wonderful and distinguished panel, my first question would be, and maybe we can start by Zeynep. Can you just share with us your experience in terms of the emerging threats, digital or otherwise, that you have witnessed in your work as an activist in Morocco, or as, you know, you communicate with people elsewhere? What are the new threats and emerging threats that you have been experiencing since the Arab uprising, since it all started in Sidi Bouzid?
Thank you very much, Hisham. And then thank you all for being here. I see that some of the people who rose their hands earlier, who are not Arabic speaking, are not necessarily wearing that little thingy that is supposed to translate. So I'm just going to continue in English to make sure that everybody gets the message. You've asked a very relevant question and also provided good background information as far as the uprisings and the subsequent sort of reaction of governments to this, to what they perceive as a threat, which is freedom of expression and freedom of use in online of the internet by activists. What I've experienced ranges sort of from, and shifts from reality to the online world. Since February 20th, 2011 in Morocco, February 20th movement, pro-democracy movement, has launched different campaigns online to rally and call for mass protests nationwide. And people have responded very well to these calls, and basically they were YouTube videos and they were Facebook pages, and that was it. There was nothing that was mentioned in print, or definitely not in state-run television. So we felt that these calls for protests and this new use of social media and just online spaces was very efficient and definitely helped us gather the right crowd so that we can call for change and make our voices heard and also communicate our demands. However, the reaction to this was very vicious from the Moroccan regime. We've encountered the way that the regime has morphed and used the secret services to set up online infrastructures and try to counter this rising movement was truly appalling in many ways. The propaganda campaign, I would say, was probably the most vicious side of it all. It was targeting activists' personal lives and also disclosing their personal information, therefore suggesting that the regime had access to activists' private data. Later on, a very large program was launched with the help of the French government and a French company called Amesis, called Bull, and the program is Amesis Eagle. I don't know if it's Eagle, but I know it's Amesis. So basically, it is based on a deep packet inspection, and it was installed. It's a very large program aimed at surveillance and aimed at making sure that there's access to people's private information. And to that effect, it created a very a sense of uneasiness among us activists, knowing that at any point in time, we have to have the skills, and we have to acquire these skills and get the training to somehow secure ourselves and our private data and still continue on, because this struggle is not simply online. It's being able to organize ourselves and then take this to real life. The way we've dealt with some of these threats was just to make disposable pages, and these have worked very well. So we would make a page. Since the information is supposed to be public anyway, then that's not really an issue. And so we would launch an event or an action a few days before, and there would be the page, and the information would be shared. And this is kind of, I guess, the regime's weakness as far as that's concerned, because they're able to track and they're able to launch propaganda campaign against activists, but they're not necessarily able to stop everything from happening. They cannot stop us online the way they stop us offline. They cannot sort of beat us up the way they do in the streets. They can't do the same thing online. It's limited. And yes, Memfek Inch has been attacked, and many activists have been targeted, and we receive direct threats. me and my family and many, many other activists. Many activists died. Going out to protest is definitely, you know, creates another sort of set of threats, physical threats. But online, it is still, we can still use the space, we are still able to also adjust to all of these rising threats from surveillance and on.
So you said they cannot stop you expressing yourself online because it's, I mean, there are maybe, as I said, unintended consequences, not direct consequences, and that has to do with maybe self-censorship, maybe, I mean, when you're targeted personally, you fear for your family, you fear for your job, your career, etc. And many people, as you told me privately, have just decided to give up. It doesn't, I mean, it's not worth it anymore because the stakes are higher. Can you give us a sense of this?
Absolutely. The stress created by this situation is definitely, I mean, it's there. People do feel that threat. Just recently, this is just a recent experience. About 2 or 3 weeks ago, we organized a protest that was violently repressed by Moroccan police in Rabat. And human rights activists, as well as pro-democracy activists, were beaten and just very violently. So what had happened is after that, having covered the event for Memfek Inch, I received these at mentions on Twitter from newly created accounts that were anonymous that would suggest that they knew some of my private information. It was just a very subtle threat. However, and this is sort of what you're talking about in terms of psychologically being targeted. Other activists have had even more vicious threats, and repetitively, they would just pound on them and be like, I don't know, I will make you eat the baton. I will rape you. Now, some of these are very aggressive, and they take a toll on some of the activists for sure. However, and this is what differentiates what the Secret Services are doing, what the regime is doing, and what the activists are doing. We are driven by this hope, this relentless quest for freedom, and it is a magnificent sort of cause that we are fighting for. However, the Secret Services are employees. They're being paid, and they are, you know, they're just subject to so many things happening in their own organization that make whatever they do, whatever work they do, not at all meaningful, if you think about it. So I think that definitely makes a difference.
Yeah, sure. Mohammed, can you share with us your experience in Jordan? I've heard of that law that was passed recently, and under the disguise of combating pornography online, but this law has also, I mean, it's a pattern across the region. There are mushrooming across the region, cybercrime laws, anti-porn laws, but do you see that these laws are efficient, or do they as well have unintended consequences, and more specifically, do they threaten your freedom online?
Well, the thing is, you've mentioned before that the governments in the region were agnostic about the internet. In Jordan, it was different. Different in the sense that the government was actually crazy about the internet. Ever since the year 2000, between the years 2000 and 2008, ICT was seen in Jordan as vital for development, and the government put so many resources into building building the structures, the infrastructure, supporting the internet, keeping it free for that part of time. And this is why, for example, in Jordan we have a relatively high penetration rate, and this is why in Jordan we have relatively a free space to discuss and share ideas on the internet. But ever since the year 2009, for some reason things started changing, because as the internet penetration grew, more people started getting on the internet. And for example, the one example you mentioned, pornography, that came as what we believe to be a grassroots event. It's a grassroots group. They're called Insaf. They started protesting against pornography in front of the Ministry of ICT, and for some weird reason, this was one of the few protests that where the government officials actually listened and decided to do something about. And yeah, but it hasn't been passed into law. They tried to do it without a law at first, but this was one of the instances where the ISPs said no. If you need to give us you either give us a list of, because that's the only way you can block a website. There's no systematic censorship yet. It's only recently started 2 weeks ago, but at that time there was no systematic censorship. And so the ISPs replied, if you want us to block porn, you have to give a list of all the pornographic websites on the internet. Okay. And nobody wanted to play that role of deciding what's porn and what's not porn. And that's why they tried to do a law, a telecommunications law. It was a draft law. The dangerous thing about that law is they had the part where they said, defined what pornography is and that they want to ban it. But they also had this whole clause where it basically allowed them to censor anything they deemed threatening to Jordan or not appropriate content.
Okay, let me now turn to to Sammy. A very, very simple question. Is Ammar 404 still alive or not? And Ammar 404, for the record, is the name that was given to the censor in Ben Ali, under Ben Ali Tunisia. Because each time you go to a website that is blocked, it displays the 404 code, and it was called Ammar 404. Is he still alive, this guy?
First, I would love to contest the use of the Ammar 404. We had a debate and fights about the use of that nickname to describe the one or the institution or the body who was censoring the internet in Tunisia. At least at nawet.org and many other activists use it to call it the ATI, the Tunisian Internet Agency, because you need to know, name, and shame your enemy at that time. Ammar 404 was just a nickname that doesn't really name and shame the guy or the institution behind the censorship. So let's talk about the Tunisian Internet Agency, which was the body, at least from what we know and from the information that we got, was responsible of surveillance and censorship. I don't think that censorship still exists in Tunisia. Through my experience, through the experience of everybody else, I think is amongst the countries, the few countries in the world where there is not a single website that is being blocked so far. But that being said, I think the threat is not coming from the ATI, because I hope that, and we've seen the ATI resisting the ban of pornographic website, which is a very positive development in Tunisia, and we've seen Muaz and his colleagues doing great deal of this resistance, supported by civil society and activists on the ground. But the threat is that there is a will and a desire of censorship based on religious and moral values that we've witnessed in Tunisia. And there is a part of the population with legitimate arguments, with, I don't know, populist argument that tries to find a justification, religious, moral, to protect our identity or our religious value, and to implement a censorship that targets first pornographic website, and then we know that all kind of censorship online starts always with moral and religious value, and then they will target political content and dissent online. But the threat is not in censorship. We know civil society and activists in Tunisia won't allow that to happen, and we will resist. The threat is surveillance, and we don't know what's going on in terms of surveillance, in terms of equipment that are being used in Tunisia. We don't know the scope of those who have been arrested because of this surveillance. We know that some have been arrested because of carrying attack in the wave of Op Israel. For example, we know that two guys have been arrested because of hacking Israeli website. One of them has been released, and the other still, I think, arrested and investigated. We know that some bloggers has been arrested or sentenced because of the use of the internet to express their view. We know that a rapper has been arrested and sentenced for 2 years because of uploading a video on YouTube labeling cops as dogs. We know that another blogger will be sentenced in July because of criticizing the situation within the military hospitals in a city, Sfax city, in the southern of Tunisia. And many, many others who have been persecuted because of the use of their freedom online. But the battle in Tunisia, I think we can deal with that. There is a vivid civil society, a very strong human rights organization in Tunisia that can deal with that threat on a legal basis, and also as an advocacy movement in Tunisia. But the most important thing, I think, is fight the non-transparency within the establishment and within the system. We don't know what's going on behind the scene, and this is, I think, the most important battle from our perspective at Nawet and many other cyber activists or just human rights activists engaging online, is to leak information. And Tunisia, I think, is among the few countries in the Arab world, in the MENA, which is engaged in a leak and a transparency and open gap fight, not by providing the legal framework that enables citizens to access the information. There is, although a law that was passed that guarantees the citizen to access governmental and administrative information, but it's not being really respected and implemented. So our role, at least from Nawet perspective, is to open up documents and to impose and shape public opinion about sensitive issue in the country. So we are in the same spirit of WikiLeaks, of global leaks, etc. We impose a debate. We try to impose a debate that we know mainstream media cannot engage in that debate because they are afraid of their job. They are afraid to address some issues. We put the information online. We try to use some kind of investigative journalism about the leaks that we are carrying online, and to impose a kind of debate, bypassing the polarization that is really marking the political debate in Tunisia, pro-Troika, pro-Islamist, or anti-Troika, anti-Islamist. So this is, from my perspective, the real battle is opening government to the world.
Sure. And before I go to Slim, could you, because, I mean, you work for Nawaj, which is a leading online advocacy organization that has uniquely made the link between, you know, working online and also has made the transition into becoming a civil society actor. And since we are talking about challenges here and threats in general, has this transition meant also for Nawaj new kind of threats? I mean, in other words, being more visible, is it more dangerous or is it a hindrance for your work? I mean, can you work more freely now that you are in the open as opposed to before?
Yeah, for sure. We work freely. I mean, our offices, we choose for us a very strategic position and location to be inside the governmental building in Tunisia. We choose Al Qasba, we choose an office which is in front of the Justice Ministry. That was our choice, and that was really a reflected choice. So we are really acting freely. We are covering news, demonstration. We have good and courageous journalists and activists on the ground to really enter the most dangerous places and to try to give voices to the voiceless and to be there when mainstream media lack presence. That being said, that we have threats. I'm not trying to exaggerate, but we have threats of burning our office. We have threats of killing our journalists. Even like a couple of days ago, one of our journalists, Amin Mtirawi, has been beaten because he was covering the trial of the rapper who has been sentenced for 2 years in jail. Actually, he has beaten several times, even inside the headquarter of the ruling party, another ruling party headquarters. So the threat exists, but it's not really targeting Nawaj as Nawaj. It's targeting everybody who tried to witness event, many other journalists who does not have big names or who are not unknown are being beaten, sometimes are being jailed. So the threat exists, but I don't think it is a strategy from the government. We know that the reform of the security service, the reform of the judiciary system is still a long ongoing process, but we try to resist. There are threats, but I don't think they are really a strategic choice from the government.
Sure. So, Slim, yesterday you had this very interesting conversation with a representative of the Islamist-led government, a representative of the Nahda party. And probably, I mean, since the toppling of Ben Ali here in Tunisia, I mean, the political scene is much more open, and it has, to a large extent, been profitable for organized parties, and namely political Islam. So if we are talking about, are we talking about non-state actors? I mean, of course, there is the establishment that was a threat for online freedom before, and it is still presumably a threat now. But are we talking about also non-state actors playing a new role? And I mean by that Salafi groups and fundamentalist groups and religious groups, etc. What's your take on that?
I'd rather take your microphone because I wanted also to ask a few questions to her about what she said. Yes, you have to understand that Islamists in general have been building up their networks, their movement for 40 years now, and in secrecy. So it's a movement in the first place, and it's a network, an international network. That international network is aimed at taking power in whatever country they can. Okay, so they don't have this notion of the state like you are talking about. So it's a mixed network. For them, it doesn't matter if it's this guy is inside the Nahda, or he has a card saying I'm from the Nahda party, or if he's Tunisian or Moroccan or whatever. Okay, what's important for them, it's that they have people with not networked with the same aim, with the same targets, and which advance in the same direction. So if if explosions in Shaambi serve their agenda, it's okay for them. They don't have to give the order for the explosions, okay? But it's managed in a way which is similar to what activists did actually during the revolution and before. It's a loose network of organization. It's hierarchical only within the party itself, but the outside of the party, which is also linked, is loosely linked, and it works that way. So yes, it's non-state actors that are in the working. It's part of their game, and they have the experience of handling these kind of organizations. So it's not by chance that everything happens in the same direction of the agenda of the ruling political party. Okay, and also, their leader, which is Ghannouchi, have a theory on that, which is more or less the clash of the civilization, so translated the clash of society or whatever. So this is with regards to the ruling party and how it works. Okay, and I wanted to comment on what Fatma? Zainab said about the Secret Service doing, propaganda threatening campaigns. We got the same thing in Tunisia because before the revolution we had censorship, technical censorship over the internet. So the voices were simply shut, not heard, okay, technically. So it's like you are saying something and it's blocked, not heard. So the Tunisian regime didn't had to handle a situation where he has to counter a rhetoric with another rhetoric or whatever. Okay, so he was sure that everything would work as it works. Once we overcame the censorship, the situation changed, and there was reinforcement of the propaganda, disinformation, all this stuff, threatening campaigns online. They understood all the political parties, the old and the new, the power of the social networks, and they invested those with armies of what we call trolls to do this job of disinformation, of threatening propaganda, etc. So it's the same situation than in Morocco, but I just wanted to ask her what exactly were the kinds of threats, how do you know they accessed your data and the data of the people they were threatening?
Right, thanks for your question. Well, like I said, the at mentions on Twitter would be worded in ways they would refer to my personal life directly in ways that I know nobody else knows. So it's one or the other. Either there's been direct access to personal data, which is probably the case, or what I thought would be the case, in my computer, data in my computer, or private conversations and chat sessions, etc. Or it is just being followed in the streets, which, you know, is also possible. So it's, you know, a mixture of online and offline. And the ad mentions usually are very subtle, but very clear. The information can only be understood by the person targeted.
Sure. We want to open the floor for questions from the audience before we go for a final round of questions and a conclusion. So, yeah, we have a question there, a second question there. If you can bring the microphones to the lady at the front.
Thank you all for your very inspiring presentations. I would like to ask you a question that's to all of you about Tunisia, because right now we're here and we are days, weeks away from the adoption of the new constitution. And this is setting a legal precedent for the whole of the region. And I'd like to ask you if you know, there are some positive elements, some people feel that it's a negative situation. Do you believe that the legal framework of Tunisia's shortly adopted constitution is going to set the right tone for freedom of expression in Tunisia and in the region?
Sure.
And why?
we're gonna go question answer. Please keep your answers concise so that we can go for a second round of questions.
No, it's almost the contrary. The constitution, like it is drafted right now, is drafted in a way where the only focus of the political parties, especially the ruling party, is on framing the organization of power or the distribution of power into the state in a way that they could keep the power for the longest period possible. So there is no intention of creating a set of laws that protect the freedoms of the citizens, in no way. On the contrary, there are some opposition parties that are trying to do that, and they are a very small part of the Constituent Assembly, and they constantly forbidden from doing it. Their phrasing is rephrased by the majority each time they're trying to ensure some freedoms to remove the freedoms that can be ensured by the Constitution. So there is a real will of removing the guarantees of freedom from the Tunisian Constitution.
Just to add that this is just a long debate and process, and the draft constitution, some articles really constitute threat to future of freedom of expression in Tunisia, especially again based on some religious and moral values, or defamation, etc., or criticizing governmental officials, ministers, presidents, etc. The legal framework, I don't think it matters a lot. It's the exercise itself of citizens of their freedom, online or offline, that really matters. And laws doesn't regulate society. Citizens regulate society by the exercise of their own freedom and the respect of their own freedom. And to push the government and to push the law to follow the rights that are being exercised by the citizen. So it doesn't matter the kind of law that they will adopt. What matter is how we gonna impose and exercise our freedom.
We have a second question from the gentleman at the front. If you can pass the microphone.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. I'm Ziad Ben Amor. I think that the challenge for the alternative media is not to fall in the trap of the classical media. I can at least witness from my own experience that access to classical media is limited to lobbying and groups from both sides. And I mean, from my experience as a trained union founder that doesn't belong to either parties, access to classical media is very difficult. And my question is, how to prevent the establishment or how to prevent falling in the trap of the classical media and to avoid the establishment of a nomenclatura for alternative media. That is a real challenge for me, and have you got an idea about how to avoid that? The second thing is that from my also observation of what is happening online, I have the impression that we are rather reactive and not constructive. It gives me the impression sometimes that the debates discussed publicly are oriented. And the thing is how to build mechanisms of resistance structured in an organized way and not just be in reactions to what is taking place in the political scene or in the scene having to do with human rights, because Sami has been talking about Hakim Ghani. What if, for example, a citizen Landa has a problem and is not well known? How just to trigger off this mechanism of self-defense? Thank you.
So, who wants to take this question? Go ahead, Mohammed.
Well, you've talked about the trap of traditional media and alternative media, and in Jordan we appear to have fallen that trap. Recently, the government modified the Press and Publications Law, which was originally bad, to include online media. And now, online media, online news websites have to go through the same processes that led classical media to be so ineffective in Jordan. And for us, this is a huge threat. But for us, it's also an opportunity. It's an opportunity to actually discuss the role of media in general in Jordan and to fight this law by all means. And but the thing is, if you want to do that, you have to build a community of people who believe in the same ideas of free press, the same believe in freedom of expression, and that's the problem we're facing. Because if you want to talk in real terms, there aren't that many people who would fight for freedom of expression in our region. There aren't that many. There are a couple, and they're really good, but we still are a small community if you compare it to the community at large. And we're seeing that in cases in certain countries where the repression or the censorship isn't coming only purely from the state, but rather from parts of the community, parts of people with influence. And this needs to change. We need to start building our bases. We need to start talking more to people, building our own movements in order to build a base where we can actually start fighting back against these laws with enough people. That's
Zeynep,
my insight.
How to build a more proactive media?
Sure. Well, to answer your question, from my perspective, I think that the solution to that is simply citizen media. That it's important for people and communities to be proactive and be able to cover events and report on things that are happening in ways that print media doesn't, or state-run Morocco's situation. So that would provide sort of an uncensored set of information that would allow for everyone to access what is actually happening. And also the fact that, and I would give an example of Memfakinch, for instance. As soon as you go legal, or as soon as you, for example, sort of establish an NGO that is monitored and controlled in many ways by the Ministry of Interior, as soon as they can go around and access your information and access you legally and can attack you, then that definitely creates a threat, a physical threat, as opposed to being online where you may be attacked, which did happen also, but I don't think the scale is as dangerous for citizen media activists as it is for, you know, for people who have established and sort of start making concessions and giving up and just becoming journalists who are sort of soft-spoken.
Thank you. I really appreciate this panel. It's really interesting to hear. It's really interesting to hear all your comments about the region and about what's happening really in Tunisia, Maghreb, and in Jordan. My question is addressed to Sammy. He mentioned very well the situation. He knows very well the situation in Tunisia, and I think he explained everything regarding censorship and surveillance. But my question is, what is your expectation regarding the surveillance? Can you live without, as we did for the censorship? Or do you think that we need to react? How we could help to have a better environment for human rights? And how can we work together to make things better for Tunisia?
Just a very quick point. Sorry to interject, but we were planning to have a round of recommendations at the end, but you can go ahead.
I think first, by opening information about what kind of surveillance are you implementing, who is really surveying the Tunisian communication, and what kind of, what are the target group that are being watched, who are being watched? We don't know. So you should answer this question, I think, later. I hope you will. Then we know that they are tapping our phone, that they are watching our communication channels, all of them, online and offline. We have, on one hand, the legal framework of surveillance. We know the threat of terrorism was always being used as an argument to find an excuse to watch and monitor all the citizens of the world, especially since 9/11, and recently with the PRISM leak, we've seen how governmental institutions supported by greedy corporation, big corporation that are using our personal data to watch us and provide that information to the government in order to know what we are doing and who actually we are online. So maybe in Tunisia the legal framework that really will set the limits that the guys who are really surveying us cannot bypass, and that body that is responsible of surveillance should be an independent body. It shouldn't be a police body. It shouldn't be a governmental body. It should be an independent body like the HICA, like the judiciary body that will watch the reform of the judiciary system. It should be an independent body composed of lawyers, advocates, human rights advocates that really respect universal values of human rights. And on the other hand, I think we need to educate people about using Tor, about using all kind of alternative platforms that tries to provide technological solution for surveillance. We know that there is no real technical solution for surveillance. It's a big dream. Maybe building a new platform that will compete with Google, that will compete with Facebook. I think that's what the open society, open source movement in the world should really foster and strengthen, like Diaspora and many other platforms. So these are the two, I think, levels of resistance to surveillance.
I have also a comment, because you said before that we don't know much about what's happening in surveillance in Tunisia. Now, you asked Muaz also to give information, but actually we know something. The Minister of Interior got to the Tunisian National Assembly and said, I'm creating a new institution for doing surveillance. It's official. So
don't know the kind of tools, we don't know what they are gathering as data, we don't know the
target. I will tell you, because I talked to the guys that will be in charge of that. Actually, they base their work on, it's actually the same guys that did the job for the ATI before. Now there'll be, they have their own institution. And the discussion was very interesting with this guy who was working for the Interior Ministry. Because we discussed actually what you were talking about, which is the independence of the institution, etc., etc. And it seems that he said to me that there are ongoing meetings on this subject, because they are making a new law for this institution. Now, this institution, unfortunately, it seems that there is no way it will be outside the Interior Ministry. So the problem is those guys have their limits. It should not be those guys who do that institution. That institution, maybe it's necessarily like you said, but it should not be a transition from the old team that was working.
I'm afraid we don't have much time. Just a quick reply from you, Zinev, and
yes,
we can take another question, but then we will have to go for a final round.
Sammy mentioned... Sammy mentioned something about some of the alternatives that could be used to counter this surveillance. And today with us is someone who I think can offer us insight in this, and I'm very interested personally as an activist to hear his perspective and hear some of the recommendations, hopefully, that would help. So I would like to invite Jake to come join us.
By all means. We're just going to get you know. It's an official invitation. Sure, by all means. If you can just allow me to give the opportunity to you, sir, to ask a question. Go ahead.
شكراً. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. حقيقة عروض جيدة ولو جئنا متأخرين لهذا يعني السيشن المهم حقيقة اللي هو تعرض لأمور غاية في الأهمية وبالتالي يعني تونس عندما نظمت هذا الاحتفالية كان يعني في وقتها كما يقال. موضوع قضية الإعلام والإنترنت والضمانات والتوازن بين المراقبة والنفاذ هذه قضايا مهمة وصعبة وحقيقة لا يمكن أن ننكر إحنا كدول عربية لازمنا في بداية الطريق في هذا الجانب نصف الحل أن تفهم المشكلة وأن تسلم يعني بالمتطلبات أوروبا يعني كلكم حضراتكم تعرفون ناضلت كثيرا حتى وصلت إلى ما وصلت إليه الآن وفي ظل التحديات أيضا الجديدة في قضايا الأمن بالإرهاب وغيره يعني
المعذرة يعني لو كان في سؤال
أقول اللي نحتاجه الآن في الدول العربية وإحنا في مرحلة انتقالية أغلب الدول ومرحلة بناء في هذا الجانب لابد أن نركز على قضيتين وجاي هذه مقدمات للسؤال وبشكل سريع أولا لابد أن نعمل على إيجاد وسائل لإنفاذ الإنترنت لكل المستهدفين يعني لا يمكن أن نتكلم عن ضمانات وقضية الإنترنت وإنفاذها محصورة بفئة معينة ممكن هذه الفئة تستطيع أن يعني تخلق من الوسائل ما يساعدها على حماية أنفسها يعني لا يمكن لدولة أن يكون 10% اللي يستفيدون من قضية الإنترنت و90% هم غير عارفين في هذه القضية بالتالي ما فائدة أن نناقش الضمانات في ظل هذا الجانب أقول ما هي الآليات اللي ممكن نركز القضية الثانية لابد يعني ما هي الجانب المؤسسي كيف احنا الدول العربية قدرنا أن نؤسس لمؤسسات راسخة دستورية فيها غطاء قانوني كأن إطار دستوري وقانوني ومؤسسات ضامنة لهذا النفاذ أقول لا يزال في هذا الجانب بعيدين عن هذا الأمر وتوضيح شكرا
Yeah, sure. First of all, is anyone interested? I mean, Mohammed, you want to answer this question? It's about tools, basically to police the internet.
هلا عندي رد سريع فقط. هلا أنت حكيت أنا ضد إن يكون في مؤسسات تتحكم بالإنترنت. أنا الإنترنت اللي بسعى له والكتير ناس بسعى له يكون إنترنت موزع ومهم النقطة الأولى اللي حكيت إن يكون متوفر للجميع. بس هاي هدول كلهم جزء من منظومات مختلفة كنا عم نشتغل عليها فلازم نشتغل مع الحكومة لازم نشتغل مع منظمات المجتمع المدني مع الشركات ونضمن إنه الإنترنت هاي تكون حق عالمي حق للجميع وهي موروث عالمي يعني مش ما لا يمتلك شخص أو شركة أو دولة يعني just to be clear the U.S. does not own the internet it's For me, I believe the internet is commons for everybody. Nobody owns it, and there shouldn't be institutions that have a control over a certain parts of the internet or the way it works. That's my own belief.
Sure. Jacob?
So I take the access discussion, and I think it's very important. But I think we have to recognize that there's a kind of false dichotomy here, which is the notion that some people are not connected to the internet. And actually, we are all connected to the internet, and we all feel the effects of the internet, regardless if we are able to use the internet to speak freely and to read freely. So there is the case that, say, 90% of a country may be offline. But those people still feel the power of the systems of control, regardless of whether or not they get the benefits of that system. And so the internet, to have a policing authority, the thing you must realize first is that you will never beat the National Security Agency and the CIA at their own game. That's very hard to accept because people don't like to be told that they're not the best, but it's just true. So we have to play a different game, I think. The world needs to play a different game. And what I mean by that is that it is absolutely critical that when you backdoor the internet to add Trojans, ask MOAs to block websites, what you're doing is you're creating vulnerabilities that will be more reliably exploited by parties that are better funded than you, and they will use it to dominate you. And so what we must accept is that if we actually secure the internet in a good way, end-to-end encryption, anonymizing the internet when it is necessary or when it is desired, giving business people and everyone access to strong encryption, a fundamental right to anonymity, a fundamental endorsement of free speech, even if it is offensive. By doing that, what we actually do is we make our whole society more secure, and it means that when outside parties wish to interfere, it will be extremely difficult for them to do so undetected, and potentially they will not interfere because they will be detected. So during the revolution, we know that Moaz was blamed, for example, for interfering with Skype communications and other kinds of communications, which in fact, to the best of my knowledge, was not Moaz, but someone else. And it isn't clear to me if it was the Tunisian telecom or if it was someone who provides internet access to Tunisia, because this is the nature of the internet. So what we must recognize is that we need to move from a passively surveillable internet to one where we require an active attacker, and the active attacker should never be the Tunisian government against the Tunisian people.
Sure.
And who is targeted is a question which we must address. It was not exactly asked by this gentleman. But when Sami says, we don't know who is targeted, I can tell you who is targeted. All of you. The question is not who is targeting you from Tunisia. The question is who is targeted. And it is everyone, sometimes by different parties. So Sami is clearly targeted by not just the National Security Agency or the AIVD from the Dutch service, I'm sure he's got both, but he's also targeted, I'm sure, by the Tunisians and by people who are not in power in the government that wish to put him down as well. So it is not a question of being targeted or not, but rather who is he targeted by and how many of those different groups. And everyone here is at least targeted by the National Security Agency, because unless you're an American citizen, you have no protections under the laws that they suggest exist right now and how they're being interpreted. Every single one of you is living in the American surveillance colony, and you have no rights. So don't deny that you are under surveillance. Instead, take action to stop making the surveillance effective, so that they may no longer dominate us.
Yeah, I think it deserves a round of applause. we're going to take a very last question from Mohammed there on the floor, and then we're going to go for a final round of your recommendation. You can start thinking about them. Your recommendation for this coalition, which after all is hosting us here, Mohammed.
هو اللي بدي أقوله أنا أكثر من جواب على الأستاذ من العراق اللي سأله أكثر من سؤال اللي أنا حابب أقوله أنه بالدول العربية كل ما يجتمعوا أي حكومة بأي بلد عربي لحتى ينظموا قانون لتنظيم الإنترنت بيطلع معهم أول شيء أنه كيف يحموا الحكام والرؤساء يعني ما بيفكروا بالمستخدمين يعني من العراق للأردن للبنان لأي بلد بعدنا لقطر للسعودية يعني في كل البلاد العربية بعد ولا بلد عربي طلع وقعدوا مع بعض ليطلعوا قانون ليحموا المستخدمين. اول شيء بحطوه عقوبة المستخدم، دغري بينزلوا لك يا سجن يا يدفع مصاري يا اما يا اما يا اما. بعد ولا مرة قعدوا على الطاولة قالوا نحن هالمستخدمين في عندهم حرية رأي، في عندهم حرية تعبير. يا اخي بدهم يسبوا شخص يسبوا، هن المسبة بترجع على الشخص، يعني اذا الشخص ما خرج ينسب يسبوا. هن ما لا بيفكروا انه اي شخص بده يذكر اي شخص بمسبة او بإساءة لازم ناخده لهذا الشخص ونضربه، نضلنا نضربه نضربه لحتى يعتذر. يعني في بعد عنا التفكير القمع بالانترنت، وهذا شيء ما بعرف كيف بده ينحل. يعني يعني كان في بالعراق قانون جرائم الإلكترونية، والأستاذ أكيد بيعرفوا أنه قانون يعني معيب جدا للأردن لحتى لبنان كان بالإي ترانزاكشن نوبل 2010. بعد ما شفت ولا حكومة عربية عم بيجتمعوا عم بيطلعوا قانون جيد لحماية المستخدم. وهذا أنا سؤال بوجهه للأستاذ، أنه شو الحل؟ يعني بس تقعدوا على الطاولة شو بتفكروا أول شيء؟ بس تقعدوا على الطاولة لتطلعوا قانون شو أول شيء بيطلع براسكم كرمال الإنترنت؟
هو مؤالي
3 minutes
3 في بداية كلامي قلت نحن لا يزال في بداية الطريق، وهذا يؤكد يعني أيضا أنا معاك متطابقين في المنظر. يعني أنا قلت لابد أن نؤسس لإطار مؤسسي. الآن قانون جرائم المعلومات تدري استغرق نقاشه في البرلمان العراقي أكثر من سنة وإلى الآن لم يقر. هو هذا اللي نريده، أكو مؤسسة برلمان، هناك من يعترض على وضع قيود لحرية الوصول إلى المعلومة. إذن في هذا الجانب ما أقول لك في العراق إحنا 100% الآن بدرجة الكمال ولا ممكن وصلنا إلى 60، لكن احنا مشينا بالطريق الصحيح. هناك برلمان يناقش هذه القضية اكثر من سنة والى الان لم يقرها. اذا هناك من يدار، لابد ان نخلق مؤسسة دستورية، وهذا ما يكفي، هذا لابد ان يكون ضامن الرقابة، الضمان الرقابة. في الولايات المتحدة الان يا اخي الى الان اكو في بعض الولايات تمييز، لكن المواطن يعرف ان هناك ضمانة، هناك محكمة تعطي لكل حق ذي حقه. لابد أن تخلق جهاز قضائي ومؤسسات رقابة قد يكون من المجتمع المدني ضامنة لإنفاذ وللحقوق في هذا المجال.
شكرا. هلأ هو أسوأ شيء تحط المواطن العربي بموقع أنه يدافع عن الحكومة الأمريكية بخصوص الإنترنت. بس بالحكومة الأمريكية عندهم حق التعبير، بس يعني فينا ناخد حكومات غير يمكن بأوروبا أفضل، انه في حق التعبير يلي هي هيدي اهم شيء، يلي هي هيدي الاساس لبناء اي قوانين معينه. وبخصوص الامن والاشياء الثانيه اكيد لازم تدافعوا عنها، بس انه اهم شيء حقوق المستخدم.
اوكي ناو we've reached the final round of questions, so I'm going to invite actually Zeynep back to the stage. And my question to the panelists including Jacob is, give us recommendations for this coalition, which is basically a governmental coalition. So as users, mainly from the MENA or with a very deep knowledge of the MENA, what would be your recommendations for this Freedom Online coalition if it really means what it says?
Well, the recommendation I have is for activists that privacy and security matter, and that it is these threats, these emerging threats from secret services and from the regimes who are resisting change and resisting youth-led movements, they have to be aware that there is a way around all of these surveillance, at least as best as we can. We have to learn and hopefully be helped in the process of learning how to secure ourselves, secure our data, secure our communications, and also push for more respect of freedom of expression on the internet.
So my recommendation is, first of all, like Jacob said, don't introduce insecurity into your system when you think you introduce security, because you don't master the systems that you are putting into your networks. And the second thing, internet cannot be free. Internet is tubes, is a technology. So it can only be neutral. It's not a matter of freedom. People using the internet should be free. So if you're writing a constitution, if you're writing new laws, provide freedoms to the people, not to the internet. And then keep the internet neutral in your policies. That way you ensure that the internet is secure for everybody, the users and the government and everybody. And then I have something to comment about what Mohammed said. It's an anecdote. You know that I've been in the interim government for 4 months, and people keep saying, okay, so you've been at the government and you did nothing. What did you do after the revolution? You're supposed to be a revolutionary or whatever. And I'm constantly saying that I was in a revolutionary mission within the government, and the mission was to بال عربي مش نميع الحكومة مش نسلك يعني الحل هو إنه لأنك كنت بتقول إنه ليش هما بيحموا دائما القوانين للحكومة القوانين للحكومة في الفكر إنه الحكومة شيء مهم وأنه يجب حمايته وأمن الدولة وأمن لا هو أمن المواطن. فأهم شيء صار في الثورة هذية أن الآن أصبحنا بنسب الرئيس بنسب الوزير بنسب وهذا مهم جدا. نعم أنا نأكد لك أنه هذا أهم شيء.
So I would say the probably one of the most important things that we can do right now is to provide political help to people that tell us how the world really works. So I would encourage everyone here to say, not just look for technological or policy related changes, but for example, each of you that has a connection to a government or to a civil society organization, I would ask you to please stand up now, and not literally, although if you feel like it, please do, and support Edward Snowden, Bradley Manning, and Julian Assange, who have worked tirelessly. Hey, you did stand up, thanks. They have worked tirelessly to be able to help everyone here in every way that is possible without a division of national boundaries. And I think that that's absolutely critical. I don't know why the rest of you are sitting down, but each one of you that has learned about the surveillance that is taking place, this is something that these people have done at great personal sacrifice. And so it's not just about policy, about encryption or anonymization. It's about the actual notion that there are people involved and that those people's lives matter, and that when they risk their lives, that we will stand in support with them, like Edward Snowden, Julian Assange, and Bradley Manning. But I would also say, we should support fundamental goals. So for example, it must be legal for you to use strong encryption. You must have the right against self-incrimination, so you may have a password that you do not disclose, so you can, say, encrypt your hard drive. You must have the right to anonymity and secure that right with actual technology. It's not just a theoretical thing, but a practical thing. I think government should also endorse free software and open and free hardware, so that it becomes possible to verify what we know, so that it becomes possible for us to become sustainable in a way that is independent from other nations' economic grasps in a very serious and direct manner. And I think this is hard to understand, but what I mean to say is that we should have the knowledge of how the world works, share that knowledge freely between each other, and to improve on it. And if it's possible to do this, then we know that whatever coalition we come up with, we know whatever policies we come up with, every person can start from the basic first principles, join the network, learn how the network works, understand when someone says something is secure, that they don't have to come from an argument of authority where they say, well, I'm the boss, therefore. Instead, we know that it's secure because of the mathematics, because through access to information, we will have this ability to educate ourselves and to educate each other. And so we can actually know that things are secure in a real, provable in some cases, way. And this, I think, is absolutely critical. And to not draw national boundaries, but to see a commonality in humanity that the internet allows us to actually express in a way that never in human history has that been possible before. And I think if that can be expressed, these fundamental goals, then that is what I think my generation is trying to bring to the table. And so you should have as many young people as possible, under 45, under 30 if possible. I don't know if you know the don't trust anybody over 30 thing, but I think what you could modify that is don't trust anybody to govern the internet or to rule the internet if they don't know anything about TCP/IP, and it doesn't matter how old they are.
Okay, I understood from Hisham that we're giving recommendations to the members of the coalition, so that's what I'm going to do. We've all sat yesterday and heard to all the government officials speaking, and they said some really sweet, kind, gentle words about internet freedom and how much they love it. But at some point, the actions of the governments that are involved in this coalition and all the governments in the world have to catch up to their words. And I think that's really important. And another thing I want these governments to understand, my government, other governments, is it's our job as civil society to assume that you're the bad guys. And for me, there's nothing I love more when that assumption is proven wrong. But it's our assumption to make sure that the powers you have do not get abused. And we need to work together on that. And that's it. Thank you.
Well, I don't have any recommendation for government and state. I don't believe in state and government. And I don't think that they will do something for the humankind. But I have to ask for something. Just if you are within a governmental body or institution that does surveillance and you want to do something for humanity and for your country, leak the information. If you don't have the courage to speak openly about it, send it secretly. You still meet us face to face if you are in Tunisia. Do something. Because if we have the information how many people are being jailed or surveyed, we can help. And we can gather and organize advocacy campaign to help those who have been arrested because of the surveillance system. So leak the information. Nawet.org is there, and we have at least the courage, I think, to publish the information and to confront the police and judiciary system. Thank you.
No. Thank you so much for this great panel. Thank you for everyone. I have a small announcement to make. There are training sessions today at 11:30. It's a security training in Arabic and English. At 2 p.m. there is a policy training in English. And both are in the Marhaba number one room. Thank you, everyone. A round of applause for the audience and for our wonderful panel.
Favorite song, a little girl with nothing wrong is all alone, eyes wide open, always hoping for the sun, and she'll sing her song to anyone that comes along. Fragile as a leaf in autumn, just falling to the ground without a sound. Crooked little smile on her face tells a tale of grace that's all around. Just falling to the ground without a sound, spinning, laughing, dancing to her favorite song. Well, she's a little girl with nothing wrong, and she's all alone. A little girl with nothing wrong, and she's all. Favorite song, a little girl with nothing wrong is all alone. Eyes wide open, always hoping for the sun, and she'll sing her song to anyone that comes along. Fragile as a leaf in autumn, just falling to the ground without a sound. Crooked little smile on her face tells a tale of grace that's all around. She'll sing her song to anyone that comes along. Fragile as a leaf in autumn, just falling to the ground without a sound. Crooked little smile on her face tells a tale of grace that's all around. just falling to the ground without a sound, spinning, laughing, dancing to her favorite song. Well, she's a little girl with nothing wrong, and she's all alone. A little girl with nothing wrong, and she's all. A little girl with nothing wrong is all alone. Eyes wide open, always hoping for the sun. And she'll sing her song to anyone that comes along. Fragile as a leaf and just falling to the ground without a sound. Crooked little smile on her face tells a tale of grace that's all her own. She'll sing her song to anyone that comes along. Fragile as a leaf in autumn, just falling to the ground without a sound. Crooked little smile on her face tells a tale of grace that's all her own. Just falling to the ground without a sound, spinning, laughing. dancing to her favorite song. Well, she's a little girl with nothing wrong, and she's all alone. A little girl with nothing wrong, and she's all. Favorite song, a little girl with nothing wrong is all alone. Eyes wide open, always hoping for the sun, and she'll sing her song to anyone that comes along. Fragile as a leaf and autumn, just falling to the ground without a sound. Crooked little smile on her face tells a tale of grace that's all her own. Just falling to the ground without a sound, spinning, laughing, dancing to her favorite song. Well, she's a little girl with nothing wrong, and she's all alone. A little girl with nothing wrong, and she's all. So hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do is just some evil scheme. A memory from your lonesome past keeps us so far apart. Why can't I free doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart? Another love before my time made your heart sad and blue, and so my heart is paying now for things I didn't do. In anger, unkind words I said that make the teardrops start. Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart?
was a time when I believed that you belonged to me. But now I know your heart is shackled to a memory. The more I learn to care for you, the more we drift. Cold, cold so hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do is just some evil scheme. A memory from your lonesome past keeps us so far apart. Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart?